All right. Yeah, thank you so much, Cohen. I appreciate it. I too am joining from North Vancouver, from the traditional territory of the Coast Salish people, the Musqueam, Squamish, and Tsleil-Waututh nations. And I'm honored and humbled to be able to raise my family and to live and work and play on their territory. We are so fortunate to have such a strong relationship with Indigenous Tourism BC, a multi-year relationship. I think it's been going on over 20 years that we've been working together. And we so appreciate the work that ITBC does to nurture the tourism businesses in British Columbia and to help bring them onto the international stage and to celebrate the Indigenous cultures around the province the way that they do. So thank you. We appreciate our partnership, and I'm so delighted to be here and to learn and hear from Sarah and Sierra today.
Awesome. Thank you so much for joining us again, Maya. So these workshops have been put on in honor of National Indigenous History Month, and that is one of the most precious things that we are offered when we visit an Indigenous tourism business, is the true history, the true and ongoing history of these lands and these territories of what is modern referred to in the modern era as British Columbia. And so, you know, I am so excited to hear about the true history of Alert Bay and of Northern Vancouver Island, as well as the ongoing, you know, culture and history of the Great Bear Rainforest with the Kitisuhehe people. And we're so honored to have them here. First up, we have a really, really wonderful opportunity to get a glimpse of the culture and heritage of a very special people, the Kwakwaka'wakw speaking people of Northern Vancouver Island. And we have a couple people here with us. I'll allow Sarah to introduce those that she's brought with her today. But we'll go now to Northern Vancouver Island on the coast of BC into the Kwakwaka'wakw territory. Sarah.
Gelikastofla, Nukwa am Machmoitamga, Gayuklinlach Yelis, Gayuklinlacha Namgris, Hitmen Gligame Sarah Fulla, Gelikastofla Indigenous Tourism BC, Glue Destination British Columbia. Welcome everyone. My traditional name is Machmoitamga. My name is Sarah Fulla. I was born and raised here in Yelis, Alert Bay, British Columbia, and I come from the Namgris First Nations tribe within the Kwakwaka'wakw territory. I just want to quickly say, Gelikastofla, thank you so much to Indigenous Tourism BC and Destination British Columbia for highlighting us today. To start it off in a really good way, the way of our people, I would like to introduce two very special people to our community and to myself, Malat Vera Newman, who will be sharing a blessing, and Gyodi Nelson, who will be sharing a song with us. Gyodi was one of my very first cultural teachers, so I'm very excited to be hosting today with him. Gelikastofla.
Gelikastofla, nugan kui molasa, kaya hamamala kajoda namgis. Iki no kis kaxi tlawi gexinu, hnukwach lak nikin gexin. Rila Kasrachta Hus. Reich noch la Iachla, wir Hustas Lachenoch Nachbar Schisakula, wir genau Idi Westrak und Lachenochweiler, das Balkome genau. Oh, gerade noch, wir Rückkass lassen noch Umistag, haben also noch Nimpana und Wila Backen und der Iachla Lachenoch Umistag. Kurs Mama der Ger, Achsel Gerchenoch, Kulismanoch, oh, gerade der Krimchen noch, müssen Mulas Gerchikirta Hus. Bila kasoch da nachko e akhlaqi qotas qora kasoch da nachkos ora ka egens wila pa pa megens mi segens ni ni da o ka misen tawe ke khnafa ging genan mit da qapot la khis khust hot la khis kai ulas. My name is Vera Newman. I'm very proud to be a board member of Umista Cultural Center. I'm very happy to be here. I come from the Mamalekla of Phillips Island, my dad's Phillips. My mother's from the Numris, the Alert Bay. I'm very proud of our Umista Cultural Center. We've worked hard to be able to uplift our people after years of not being able to be who we are as Native Bakum people. So we work together always to help uplift us and do it, learning our traditional ways and in a good way. It's not, we're not putting on a show. We're learning, we're teaching people the truth about our history. And we're really a part of it. And I'd like to open with a hawakala in our Kwakwala language. We walk beside a gate, Rila Castle, Cotanala, Rila Castle, the economics of Kernokechano, Clary Gerken of Fnukeno, or a mula scare Kirir. Mirasco no Gerken of Willa Dasha eat no cray, Kernohisila, no, his Megan of Hilliams, and we're going to hear my Cresco no Hitler, no Naka Wigilasa, Rila Castle, all my relations. We were really proud of Sarah. Sarah's one of my little relatives. One of my younger relatives, I shouldn't say little, one of my younger relatives, and I'm going to do everything I can to help her. Because we continue to uplift our people, it's better for all of us. Bila Kestopla.
Kila Kesla, Kila Kesla, Mahmoudjimka, Chitla Gachin, Fatnala, Kila Kesla, Nimkais. I am extremely happy to be here as well to support Mahmoudjimka. Super proud to be in our Utmista Cultural Center, a center that strives to keep our culture alive for the future generations. We, the Kwakwaka'wakw, just like every other First Nations in the province, have had our trials and tribulations to keep our culture alive. We are extremely proud to have the center here in Alert Bay, where we could come to gain strength. It was 100 years ago that Dan Kramer had his potlatch in December of 1921. And the artifacts that you see here were the masks and regalia that were confiscated 100 years ago. We are extremely proud that no matter what the Canadian government tried to do to get rid of our people, that we know who we are, where we come from, and we are extremely proud of it. It is now our duties to teach our children what we were taught by our old people. And so I am extremely proud to support Umista. I am extremely proud to support Mahmoudjimka and the work that they do here to share our culture, to share our ways with the world, to educate people so that there could be a better understanding, so that we could move forward together as one. And so today I felt it was very important and very appropriate to sing a song from the Nimgais people, a song that originates from the Guatney River. And this was a song that our granny, Granny Ahu, had taught. And I'm going to get my auntie to explain a little history of how we learned this song.
Through all the work of Umista, Salmonista was a video crew that videotaped all of different tribes and their origin stories. And Salmonista was formed, and they took the old people to a tour around the different villages and talk about what they remembered. And Granny, after they got back, they asked Granny to sing a song to finalize the event that they just have had. So she sang the river song. She said, she said, it belongs to the Nimgais. What you see on the highway is river. It's called Guatney, and it's Gai from our river. It talks about our Kutala. And she also taught another fun song, which we took off of TV. We took off a recording off of TV, made tapes for our young, that the wealth that will continue to flow forever from our river, the Guatney River. So, Bela Kesla.
Once again, I just felt it appropriate to get grounded with that song of the Guatney River. I too have Numgris ties. I have ties with the Mustamau Tzawadinuch, the Numgris, the Mamalilkhla. And so it's a reminder to our people, the sacrifices that Guatnalalis made. He was given the choice way back when. What do you want to become? Do you want to become a mountain? Guatnalalis said, no, I do not. Mountains will crumble. Do you want to be a cedar tree? No, I do not. Cedar trees will get struck by lightning and fall to the ground and rot. Would you want to be a river? And Guatnalali said, yes, I want to be a river so that I could flow till the end of the days, so that my people could benefit from me. And so it is a reminder of the sacrifices that Guatnalali's had for his people, and to be giving and kind to one another. And so we are extremely proud, like I said earlier, to know who we are and where we come from. We are still here, despite all of the efforts of the Canadian government to basically get rid of us. And we have a lot to share the world. And so, Qila Kesla, I'm extremely proud to be here. Qila Kesla.
Qila Kesla, thank you so much.
We'd like to remember our chairman of the board right now, Bill Cranmer, chairs for him to help him get back to good health. And I'm just proud of our Umista, because for the first time ever, we have all our own people working in our cultural center. And we're so proud to stand up with the young people, help uplift our nations. Leila Kessler.
Thank you so much. And if I could just jump in, I just want to say our heartfelt thanks. That was absolutely beautiful. And we're so touched that you were able to willing to share so much beauty with us. I know for me, and I know Maya, we have lots of questions and things. I'd just like to share with all those on the line as well. There is a Q&A section at the bottom. So if you'd like to ask a few questions, I see a lot of comments coming in and well wishes to Sarah and all of you over at Umista. But I really recommend that you pop some questions into the Q&A section as well. And we'll make sure that if we can, we'll ask them along the way. But again, thank you so much. I raise my hands to you, because that was just so touching to have you share all of that knowledge and history and culture with us. My first question is all of the questions is the beauty of your regalia, the all that surrounds you, and some of the stuff you've talked about already, are the potlatches and the beauty of your culture. One word that I would love for you guys just to share with everyone tuning in is the word Gila Kesla. We've heard it a couple times from you guys, and just as a jumping off point for me, I would love it if one of you would be willing to share the meaning of that. Sarah, and then, share some more about the space that you're in and the beautiful culture that and art that you have surrounding you right now.
Yeah, so Gila Kesla means welcome, and it also means thank you in our Kwakwala language. Gila Kestautla means thank you all and welcome all. So it's more of a plural when it's a greeting.
I would love to ask you, Sarah, first of all, thank you, Vera, and thank you, Cody. That was unbelievable. So beautiful, for the gift of song and the gift of the blessing. So thank you. I have an opportunity. I actually am coming to Alert Bay and to the Amustik Cultural Center this summer, and I'm so excited. And I'm just wondering, what is it that we can expect, as a visitor can expect when they come to the cultural center. We may be experiencing technical difficulties.
Well, oh, if we have Sarah back, perhaps not. For me, I just wanted to say that the beauty of sharing this story and song is it was just so heartfelt, and I just can't even begin to describe how amazing it is to be able to connect with Sarah and everyone over at Amista through this virtual space. So we're very honored that you'd be willing to welcome us in even virtually right now. But I know for a lot of people out there, they're actually hoping to get there this summer. I think we have Sarah back here. Maya was to just ask if, what those that are excited about coming to UMISTA hopefully this summer might expect when they do arrive and in looking at all of this beauty around you, you know, what is the story that they're going to hear while they're there?
Story of how this happened. This was taken from us 100 years ago, and we've had the opportunity to store it here at the UMISTA. You know, UMISTA means the return of something important. I've also heard that it means the return of our treasures. So this potlatch collection is our treasure. Again, it was taken by the Canadian government. It was put in other museums, it was put in private collections, and we work hard at UMISTA to receive and to get them all back to their rightful home. And what you may experience, we recently created a schedule for July and August. So when coming to UMISTA, it's a first come, first serve basis, but you will be able to have tea with two of our local artists, Bruce Alfred and Wayne Alfred. You'll have the opportunity to learn how to cedar weave with Donna. You will learn about the medicines with Eva. There's fun at UMISTA. And of course, Kwakwala, learning Kwakwala with our elders, but also with Pee-wee.
And is there a website, Sarah, that people can learn more information about, or if they can come and plan their trip?
Yeah, so we're mostly using our social media. So Facebook and Instagram, we're sharing a lot of posts about what's kind of going on weekly here at the UMISTA Cultural Society or Center. But also you can check out our website at www.umista.ca. And to learn more about who we are as a people, our land, and our language, you can check out, and the potlatch, you can go to www.umistapotlatch.ca. And I believe it's going to be shared in the chat.
So just for those that are a little bit curious, I'm wondering if you can explain a little bit about the potlatch. And you mentioned that all of the beautiful art around you is from a potlatch collection. So, you know, what is the potlatch in your culture?
Yeah, I'll try my best to answer that. Potlatches are our way to document very important events in our lifetime. And before the Europeans came, we didn't have a written language. Everything was passed down orally. And so this happened from generation to generation to generation. And our ceremonies, our potlatches, what we call them today, were an opportunity to pass down chieftainships from people to the next generation. They also were memorials. They also were name giving to people reaching puberty or other stages in their life, marriages. And so it was the way that we documented and validated who we were as people. And so all of our tribes have their own origin stories and where they come from and where they where their stories and songs and dances come from. And so at these ceremonies, the host would show his family's stories and retell them in dance form and in legend. And so this was something that was very frowned upon with the early Europeans. And unfortunately, they put a stop to it. And for a number of years, our people up and down the coast were not allowed to potlatch. And it wasn't, weren't allowed to speak our language. And it wasn't until 1951 where that potlatch ban was lifted. And so it's important to state that even though the governments of the day tried to stop us, we never, ever stopped. And we had to get creative, and we had to do it in the wintertime when the weather was crappy, so the police couldn't come to our villages. And so that is why we are so fortunate to have our culture as intact as it is today.
And what does it mean to you to have, you know, those pieces back in your care, you know, that were taken and brought all over the world and then finally repatriated home to your community? You know, what does it mean to have a center like Umista to be able to tell the story from your, from tell the true story of these pieces?
Back in the day, in 1980, when Umista was built, when we opened Umista, the present old people at the time decided that instead of giving it back to the families that these treasures belong to, that we, the center would hold it, that people, the young artists are able to come and replicate whatever belonged to their family. There was a choice of the old people at that time. And so we use this center that Jordi has already mentioned to continue to find our way back to our young people to make connection to who they are and where they come from, because a lot of our people have lived in the urban centers. But the young people in Lurie Bay are taught in both the schools, our language, our dances, our songs, our history, and we used the center so that the young people could continue to feel and develop good feelings about who they are, because I certainly didn't have that when I was younger, because we weren't allowed to speak our language. If we spoke it, we got hit. And so this center is very important to our people. And we give thanks to people like Gloria Webster, who really worked hard to, when it was first built, and Doug Cramer, who help build this building. We continue to encourage our young people to learn. And so it's important for my age group now to always talk about what's most threatened right now, even now today, is our language. And one of the reasons why we have a cultural group called Tsasatla is to continue to teach, once we were allowed to dance again, to continue to teach what the old people taught us when we were younger, that we continue to know how to conduct ourselves, how to behave, how to treat people. Those are very important for my age now, for our young people to know. It's not just dancing and singing, there's far more to it. So we really applaud the work of Tsasatla Cultural Group. In our language, Tsasatla means to be determined. And unfortunately, because of COVID, our big house has been closed. But we used to open our doors on Thursday and Friday and Saturday to share our history and our songs and dances with the permission from the chiefs that owned them, so that we could to educate the big world, and we just dance for whoever showed up there. So we hope this year that we can do it. Maybe we'll have to do it outside because we have no facility right now to share it, but hopefully we can do it outside Umista this year.
That would be amazing. Mm-hmm. I know there's a lot of questions coming in, and we'll have another opportunity, hopefully at the end, to answer some more. But we have people joining from all over the world, and one of the questions that I'm seeing from a grade 3 class actually is if you could tell us a little bit about your headbands and maybe about some of your regalia.
Yeah, so our people would weave cedar, red and yellow cedar. To make headpieces, regalia, such as what Jody is wearing here, that's a neck ring. It's a practice that is still done today. We share workshops in the summertime, as I kind of just mentioned, And next week for Indigenous Peoples Day, we will have some cedar weaving with our community. The cedar is considered to be the tree of life to our people. We used every single piece of the cedar tree, from the roots, the bark, the branches, and the roots. Yeah, and so every single piece of the cedar tree was very important to our people, and I'm really happy and proud to say that we still use it in a lot of different practices today, such as regalia and baskets and headpieces.
Mm-hmm. Amazing. And your blankets too, they're so beautiful, and your vests and tunics.
Thank you. This blanket belonged to my great-grandmother, Mankiogwa, Ethel Alfred, who was Mamalili Kala, but married into the Namkais, where we are from today. And she was married to my great-grandfather, Chief Elvin Alfred of the Namkais. And you can see there's some abalone. It's a button blanket, mm-hmm. and our some crests. I don't know if you can see. It's a...
Oh, beautiful.
Unbelievable.
Sorry. Wow. That's incredible.
We use this in our ceremony when we are dancing. It's something very special to our people. And we actually have a few on display here at the Umista by the Chief Knox. Correct. Mm. And one of our Tlingit ancestors, Anislaga. The Chilkit blanket, yeah.
It's incredible.
Well, I hope we have some more opportunity at the end here to talk a little bit more. I know we have some more questions, and I could talk to you guys for hours on end, I'm sure. If someone was to come to Umista this summer, though, or any summer in the future, how much time do you think they should allot themselves to, explore and be in Alert Bay?
There's a lot going on in Alert Bay. So I would say I would promote a weekend, really get that relaxing feel here. It's that island life, Pacific island life. There's a lot to experience. Obviously, come to the Umista. I would recommend going out on a tour with Seawolf Adventures. I would recommend going to get bannock from Duchess's Bannock. I would recommend going to Culture Shock and experiencing some of their programs. And then Tafla when they're up and running this summer, again, they're Thursday to Saturday, and we'll have more information on what's kind of going on if we find a facility to host those performances.
And Sarah, are there places to stay in Alert Bay, or is Port McNeil a good sort of base camp, so to speak?
There is lots of places to stay here in Alert Bay. There's Sane Boat Inn, there's the cabins, the Alert Bay cabins, there is the Nimkish Hotel, and there is the Orca Inn, and there's actually quite a few Airbnbs now. Mm. So there's quite a few places to stay. You can come to Alert Bay and stay here.
Awesome.
Also, go hike through the ecological park. It's such a beautiful place to just bring your family.
Awesome. Maya, how excited are you to go this summer?
I seriously can't wait. And honestly, looking at some of the chats, there's lots of people that look like they're going to be coming, or some people from overseas that are hoping to come soon. So yeah, thank you so much. That was incredible. Sarah, Vera, and Cody, thank you. It's unbelievable. Thank you.
Exactly. And we will hopefully come back to you guys shortly. And for now, we will travel a few hundred kilometers north of Alert Bay into the Great Bear Rainforest on BC's north coast, south of Prince Rupert. And we're going into the Kitisuhehe territory, where Sierra Hall of Spirit Bear Lodge, a absolutely incredible experience and accommodation and full lodge, where they have food services and activities and accommodations and everything is joining us. It's a dream trip for me to go up to Spirit Bear Lodge. I'm sure every time I go in my lifetime, because I hope I can go a couple times, will be a once in a lifetime trip. But for Sierra, it's her every day, which I'm so jealous about. And we're so honored that you're willing to join us and share your story, Sierra. Is there any way I can get you to show me what your view looks like? Because I just know you must have an incredible view from where you are.
Hi. Yeah, for sure. Right here behind me is just kind of the dining room where we have our dinners and stuff. But here is the front view.
Oh, my.
When you look out the window.
How jealous are you right now, Maya?
I sure wish I was able to go there.
Yeah, me too. Well,
it's definitely a rainy day up here, but...
Totally. Amazing. Well, we're so thrilled that you were able to join us, Sierra. And I, you know, hearing it myself, I know how incredible your journey into tourism and into your own territories through the Spirit Bear Lodge has been. So I would love to just give you the floor and hear a little bit about your experience in working with within the Indigenous tourism industry, specifically in your home community at Spirit Bear Lodge. Sierra?
Yeah, for sure. So I guess I'll start now. So, yo, everyone. My name is Sierra Hall. I am from the Kitisew KK's Nation in Klemtu, BC. Klemtu is a remote First Nations community on the central coast of British Columbia with a population of roughly 500 people. And I am tuning in today from Spirit Bear Lodge, and I work as a tour guide up here. I guess where I'd like to start off is I would like to thank Indigenous Tourism BC and Destination BC for hosting this event and asking me to speak on behalf of Spirit Bear Lodge. And to begin my presentation, I will talk a little bit about the background knowledge of the tourism industry in Klemtu. So this lodge here is owned and operated by the Kitisew KK's Nation, and it has grown tremendously over the past couple of decades. Tourism started out here very small in the early 2000s, and it focused primarily on walking tours within the community for kayakers or people passing by on their trips to Alaska. And considering we are located in the Inside Passage Route to Alaska, we are in the perfect spot for tourism in British Columbia. And I guess moving away from walking tours, the nation then began to utilize the resources within our traditional territory, such as the scenery and wildlife, but our target market was the bears. People want to see grizzly bears, but most importantly, our very, very famous spirit bear. In the beginning, our guest accommodations started out as one float house with only 3 bedrooms. And we used to use an open aluminum skiff to transport to the rivers, and anywhere you go within the territory to view bears is about an hour or two. So having an open skiff was definitely something different back then. And your guide back then was also your skipper, your cook, your housekeeper, and overall, just your host. But with each successful year, we grew bigger and we went from Spirit Bear Adventures to Spirit Bear Lodge. We now have a lodge built within the community with 12 rooms, making our guest max capacity 24 people. And with that being said, we're currently content with the size of our lodge, as it's not too big to make a negative impact on the wildlife. And it kind of makes our guest interactions that much more special. So the tourism industry has brought many things to my community, but some important topics I'll talk about today is the way tourism impacted the people of Klemtu, and more specifically, the way it impacted me directly. You see, I grew up in this very remote community and experienced the hardships of living somewhere so secluded from the rest of the world. I grew up being taught only parts of my culture and language, as only a century prior, it was being stripped away from us in residential school systems. There were only bits and pieces of my culture that made it to survive that system. And as a result of that, I was very embarrassed to practice my culture or even attempt to learn how to speak my native tongue. So I was always really confused with my identity and struggled with being a proud Indigenous kid. But with each successful year at the Lodge, our name was reaching the farthest parts of the world. And Spirit Bear Lodge started to attract many different people, you know, and these people who were interested in our culture and our traditional practices. And being a part of the Lodge and seeing this connection between us and our guests really brought me a sense of cultural pride, and I started to feel proud of my heritage. That is kind of, I guess, where I think that tourism is a form of cultural revitalization and reconciliation. It truly, truly makes, and you know, medicinal plants. You know, we also get the opportunity to visit cultural sites in our territory or canoe runs.
So Sierra, we're just getting a little bit of a breakup here. If you maybe just pause for a second, we might be able to kind of let Zoom catch up. I think one of the reasons that someone should go to Clem 2 is the remoteness, but it certainly doesn't lead to very good internet connection, I'm sure,
in general, or
spotty. So I don't know if you can hear me again, Sierra. Oh, maybe not. Oh, there we go. We have you back now, Sierra. Sorry, we were just getting a little bit of interruption there. But we have you again, so please feel free to continue.
Okay, I don't know where I kind of got cut off there.
So you were just talking a little bit about the impact that it's had in terms of cultural revitalization, but also in terms of your own, new or deep connection with your culture that's been able to be really built upon through your work at Spirit Bear Lodge, which was beautiful. You know, I think for us, it really speaks to the heart of what a conscientious visitor is looking to do. They're looking to make an impact in communities and in the areas that they're visiting. And you're such a prime example of the magic that is your willingness to share and to bring people in, but also, you know, as a visitor, our ability to kind of learn something and learn about the history of these places and make a positive impact by attending. So if you wanted to share a little bit more about kind of your journey of kind of coming on board to Spirit Bear, but also how you've seen yourself kind of grow since you started at Spirit Bear in terms of your own cultural revitalization within yourself.
Yeah, I mean, the history here is so rich. And the fact that tourism is creating that bridge for us to share our history is so empowering to me. And I'm pretty sure to my whole community. I'm super grateful for the platform that Spirit Bear Lodge has given us in terms of, you know, sharing our culture and getting to take guests out into our traditional territory. Because I think this is something that as a resident here from Clem 2, have taken advantage of. I live in this very pristine, like beautiful territory, but I was this kid that always wanted to go to the city and, you know, see all those kinds of things until I started working at the Lodge and I started to appreciate and, you know, really see things in a bigger picture. With guests coming in and being like, oh, this is such a beautiful place. Like, I can't believe you live here all year. And it just really kind of put my mind into perspective of being like, yeah, you are right. Like, it's gorgeous. And I do not appreciate that enough. And now working with tourism, I definitely appreciate it every day that I'm out in the field.
Well, and I know in hearing the stories of people who have gone, and even seeing some of the people in the chat here who have had the pleasure of and the awe-inspiring trip of attending a tour and staying at Spirit Bear Lodge, you know, what is that like to see someone go into these territories that are so special to you and your people, and for them to have kind of a transformative experience?
It's really great because, you know, how I kind of mentioned about how we kind of use bears as our target market to get, you know, people to come and experience this place. But, you know, people come here for the bears, but I think they leave being in love with our culture or finding a new love for the Indigenous culture. So it's really amazing to kind of see that. And it makes my community feel so proud to be Indigenous, because we, you know, like, the oppression has been so real in my community and all First Nations communities. But I see the difference within my people and their cultural pride with tourism coming into the community. And even with, you know, connecting with outsiders, because we're so secluded and we're not used to, you know, seeing many different people except for the people within the island. So it kind of, you know, gives people confidence to be out of town as well, if that makes sense.
You know, Sierra, as somebody who has had a chance to speak with international visitors that we work with around the world and tour operators, I know what you offer is something very special and so greatly appreciated by people who get to visit from other countries. So I just wanted to just say that. I know it's with a capacity of 24, I know you're also highly sought after. And so I believe you're closed this year, but you're preparing for next year and the year after, is that right?
Yeah, so our status right now is we are closed for this season. And next season we are opening for Canadian visitors only. So, and then in 2023, we will be booking for international as well. But as I've heard from my boss, I believe that we are almost fully booked into 2023. So
we're looking at 2024 for our international visitors at this point.
Yeah.
Gives people a chance to plan, I suppose, eh?
Yeah, I'd say.
Totally. So for me, if you would just indulge me a second, it's called Spirit Bear Lodge. What is the Kitisuhehe's people's, you know, connection to the Spirit Bear, and why make that such a integral piece of your business?
Well, the Spirit Bear is definitely unique to our area. So that has been very helpful for us. But, and like, there's only like a span of an area where the Spirit Bear population is. And I believe it reaches all the way up to kind of like the bottom of Alaska. And then it ends here at Kitisuhehe's territory. But going in to talk about how the Spirit Bear relates to my culture and my people here, we always tell the story of that's been passed on to us. Like Yuri said earlier, everything that was passed on was oral. So there's nothing written. Everything that was passed on was, you know, told in a story or in a song. So the story behind the Spirit Bear for my people is that during when we were in the time of the Ice Age, the raven, who is known as a trickster to my people, I guess the raven must have turned 1 in 10 black bears white to remind us of the time when we were in the Ice Age. So that's kind of our explanation of why the Spirit Bear is white.
That's so beautiful. And what do you think in your culture, what's the significance of seeing a Spirit Bear, of coming upon one and being in the presence of one for both you as the peoples of the area, but also for a guest who's visiting?
It's definitely a life-changing experience because of how unique the spirit bear is. And it's almost like they grace you with their presence. Like, they're so difficult to find. And if they pop out, then they want you to see them. Yeah, so that's how I can answer that question.
What about for you? Like, even though you work at this job and you're there all the time, you know, what is that experience like for you? Do you feel it's a blessing or you know, what is the meaning that you find in actually, you know, finding coming upon a spirit bear or it popping out, as you said?
Well, picture yourself in a forest where it's like, you know, completely green for miles and all you can see are trees and, you know, like, the shade of the trees, and then you see this white majestic big bear come out of the bushes and you're kind of like, oh my goodness, like you're obviously not expecting to see a white bear, but when it does happen, it's almost magical. Like, I've had many guests cry at their first experience, and I cried my first time seeing a spirit bear. So it's definitely a spiritual feeling to be in the presence.
Well, I'm very excited to one day come and at least try to come and see a spirit bear. That being said, I would be very, very happy to see any bear in a tier in Klemtu and then the Kiso Hehe territory. I think that would be a pretty magical thing. I'll remind everyone that the Q&A is still open. If you have any questions for Sierra about Spirit Bear Lodge, I would really recommend you put them in the Q&A over the chat, just because they can sometimes get lost as other people are also messaging. You've had many, many people that have shared how much your words touched them, Sierra, and said, you know, that they too have come and had some of the experiences you've talked about, and they can attest that it is that magical and that wonderful. And like I said, it's a dream trip for me, I know. And for you too, I'm sure, Maya. Is there anything else that you wanted to ask, Maya?
I guess what else can, when one is at Spirit Bear Lodge, are there opportunities also to meet some of the locals? Are there opportunities to learn? What are some of the other experiences other than seeing the wildlife that we see? Sorry, Sierra. visitor.
All good. Yeah. Yes, and I also recommend everyone check out the Spirit Bear website. You know, just to, even if they're not booking for this year and next yet, or if they're full for next year, even just seeing some of the photos and the videos and all of the content that you guys share is still enough to bring you out of wherever you are and immerse you into the beautiful territory of the Kitisu Hehe and into the programs and tours that are offered through Spirit Bear. Maya, I'll give it back to you to pose the question again.
Oh, yes, Sierra, I was just going to ask you what else.
Yeah, sorry about that, guys.
Yeah, no worries. What else can somebody experience when they come to Spirit Bear Lodge?
So I guess aside from bears, we do all sorts of wildlife. So, you know, as we're driving out into the field, we're always watching the shorelines for, you know, bears or wolves. We're always watching the waters for whales, like humpback whales and orcas, you know, sea lions. There's so much wildlife up here. But apart from the wildlife, we do cultural tours within the community if there's interest. So that just kind of means like one of the guides will take you to our big house and tell you some stories, show you the totem poles, and just, it kind of really depends on what you're interested in when you come here. We can also do some kayaking around the area. It's very open.
That's fantastic. Thank you. Thank you for sharing. Yeah.
Thank you so much, Sierra. I have another question here from Colleen. If you know, everything was open and in terms of booking, when might a person book to have the best chance at seeing a spirit bear specifically if they were so inclined?
Good. That's a good question, because it will show right on our website the times of what, when to book and what you will most likely see. So Prime Spirit Bear viewing is September and October, maybe late August, but it really depends on the salmon run, because you know, black bears, their diets are berries and salmon. So we go to rivers to sit and wait for bears to pop out. So when we're looking for a spirit bear, that's where we go and look. And they'll only come out, obviously, when the salmon are running. So we can't kind of like go into the bushes and look for them while they're eating their berries. But it's best to book, I'd say, in late August until the end of our season in October.
And other than the bears themselves, what's your favorite thing to do or see when you're in your territory?
There's so much. I definitely love the bears, but you know, like, and it's not, when you're on the trip, there's a lot to it. As guides, you know, we do all this kind of training for interpretation on culture and medicinal plants and how to traditionally harvest food within the territory. So I, as a guide, I kind of like to make sure you get the full package. So say like we leave the dock in the morning, we're off to see bears, but I'll also tell stories about the culture. And I'll, you know, when we're passing by a certain area, I'll be like, oh, that's where we go and harvest seaweed. Or that's where, you know, we go and harvest herring eggs in the spring. And I can just talk about all that. I think I don't have a favorite part. I think it's all really great for me. And I don't even feel like this is a job. It's.
And for the guests that do come, other than the bears, what is another piece that is their favorite piece that they take away, or the thing that sticks with them the most?
I would say when they get to do things like see pictographs and petroglyphs, which are rock paintings and rock carvings. And it's really amazing to see, because it's ancient art, right? That's just been there for God knows how long. That's always really, really great for our guests as well.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much, Sierra. And I think we are kind of running out of time here. So if there was any kind of other questions for either Sierra or Sarah, I would really recommend that you guys could, or everyone joining in could post them into the chat. Or if you'd like, you can contact Indigenous Tourism BC. Sierra and Sarah, any final words to all those who are joining in? Sierra, I see you have your mic still on. Did you have anything else you wanted to share with everyone who's joining in?
I just wanted to say, you know, thank you for having me. It's always an honor to speak on behalf of the lodge, and I look forward to seeing some of you come out to see some bears and maybe learn some culture.
Yeah, and Sarah? I just say, Gila Kasla, thank you so much for being here with us today, and a big, huge, warm thank you to my Auntie Guimalas and my cousin Gyori for singing and giving a blessing today. And being hosts throughout the whole presentation, it was really great to have different perspectives. Again, Auntie Guimalas Vera has been here since day one with the Umista, and again, she's a board member, so her perspective is very important. So Gila Kasla, thank you. And again, we're sending some well wishes to our chair, William Cranmer, wishing him vibes. Gila Kasla.
Gila Kasla, thank you so much to both of you. And I will remind everyone on the call that we do have one more of these virtual workshops coming coming up on Tuesday, and that will be around Indigenous wellness. So we hope that everyone has signed up. There will be a recording of this that will be posted through the Indigenous Tourism BC website and YouTube page as well. So we recommend that all of you go and check it out, or if anyone wants to share it with friends or family, please feel free. Again, a big thank you. I really appreciate, and I believe I can speak for everyone on the call in saying that we really appreciated Sarah Guimalas and Cody's time, as well as Sierra Hall up from and all those that I believe were representing Spirit Bear Lodge through the chat as well and answering questions. To Maya and Destination BC, again a big thank you, a big Gila Keslahawa for being a part of this and your ongoing support. British Columbia is a incredible place filled with so much diversity within the Indigenous cultures and non-Indigenous cultures. And for any of you who are tuning in from abroad, whether you're you know, expats, Canadians abroad, or whether you are wanting to come and share in some of the beauty of British Columbia, but also the richness in its culture and art as well, we say welcome to you, and we hope to see you soon as things open up when the time is right. In so many of our Indigenous cultures, we say everything is connected. We are all connected to each other as well as to the land, and it is through culture that we celebrate those connections. So I say thank you again for joining us, and we hope to see you on Tuesday. Maya, did you want to have a last remark?
Just to say thank you to Indigenous Tourism BC and to you, Cohen. Fabulous questions. Got a chance to hear from Sarah and Sierra in their communities, and I just really appreciate that opportunity. So on behalf of Destination BC, thank you to you.
All right, wonderful. Thank you, everyone.